Welcome to season 10. I love when polar opposites come together to do something magical. Hi, I'm Alicia Butler-Pierre, and it always brings me joy when I can work with creative people. Being that I'm on the more technical side, I focus on back office operations. You know, the behind the scenes stuff that customers don't see, but definitely experience. And you're about to get an up-close view of what I'm talking about. In this episode, I'm going to work with a graphic design consultant. She's created events for other freelance creatives, and though she's done an amazing job at getting some of them to sign up, many of them don't actually attend the events. It's called a low lead to customer conversion, and we're going to create a process to change that. This is season 10, episode 119. Let's start the show. This episode is brought to you by Equilibria, the company through which I provide consultations like the one that you're about to hear and or see. You can learn more about how I give these consultations at eqbsystems.com. Again, that's eqbsystems.com. And joining me today for today's live workflow workshop is none other than Miss Ericka Bates in Spartanburg, South Carolina. Hey, Ericka. I am so glad to see you. Welcome to the show. How are you today?
So far, so good.
And let me explain to everyone why I'm so excited about this for several reasons. One, we're going to be talking about a LinkedIn conversion process. Ericka and I actually met on LinkedIn, and I think we connected sometime in 2019, and we've just been advocates of each other ever since, kind of being each other's cheerleaders online. And it was Ericka and another person, Edward Moore, the two of them actually suggested doing these live workflow workshops on the podcast. So I have Ericka and Edward to thank for that. So before we get into the actual live session, the actual processing piece of this, you do some really fascinating work with creatives. I know that you are a consultant at a company called Subconscious Self. Tell us more about the work that you do there and the people that you work with.
So I mostly work with freelance graphic designers, and the idea is to move them from being a freelancer mindset and onto the mindset of being a business owner. And we do this through masterminds, master classes, and group coaching.
Okay. So that's what you do, and that is certainly needed because we are in the gig economy, especially with the pandemic right now. So I know that the services that you're providing are more important than ever right now during this time. Now, before we get into, we're actually going to start to talk about the process that you specifically wanted to talk about during our session today. So at this point, we're going to go ahead and actually take a listen to that video that you submitted where you describe the very specific process that involves LinkedIn that you want to improve. Let's go ahead and take a listen to that right now.
This is Ericka Bates with Subconscious Self, and the process I would like help with is conversions for my mastermind. I want to walk you through what I've been doing so far. So this is what I've been doing so far. I create an event in LinkedIn. So far, 328 people said they would attend. And they would go here where it says join here, online event. It will take them to my landing page. Tells you a little bit about me, tells you about a little bit about the event. Has the first event we've ever done. Come down here, it's $47 to join the mastermind. Let's go. You put your name and information, and it will put you on a list. So far, I go to my events. I'm sorry, my dashboard. Only one person has signed up for the Monday, October 5th mastermind session. So what I would like to do is find out how I can get the 300 plus people to, or at least some of them, to convert. So when you do LinkedIn events, you can come over here and you can see the 328 people who signed up for the event. I've messaged at least to page 14 or 16. Some of them say thank you. Some of them say, I don't remember signing up for this event. But any insight you got, I would appreciate. So thank you for your time, Alicia.
So Ericka, you want to talk about a conversion process, particularly using the events feature on LinkedIn. The last time I checked, a 10% conversion is doing really well, but don't quote me on that. I want to make sure that I do some research before we actually talk about it on the podcast. But for now, the one thing that I want you to think about is customer centric. In other words, we need to talk about a process from your potential customer's perspective and not necessarily from your perspective as the facilitator. So there's three things that I want you to focus on. Number one, what happens from your potential customer's perspective the moment they press that attend event button on LinkedIn? Number two, are you using an email marketing system? And number three, if you are using an email marketing system, which one are you using, and are you actually directing your potential attendees to that list? So we'll talk about those three things and more as we map out a potential customer conversion process for attending your events on LinkedIn.
Okay, so Ericka, that was great stuff. So you're looking at increasing conversion with these LinkedIn events, or I should say events that you are advertising and promoting via LinkedIn. I'm going to ask at this time, would you mind, you did such a great job of walking us through it in your video, but can we walk through that again? Can you go ahead and share your screen on LinkedIn so that we can see exactly what you're doing?
The event is Freelance Graphic Designers Attract High-Paying Clients in 30 Days.
Okay.
So far, 369 people pushed a button saying that they would attend. I can go to this. Oops, sorry, wrong button. I can go to the list that says see all, and I can see everyone who pushed a button that said that they would attend.
Okay.
So what I've been doing so far, I would click on a name, and I would either message them. I've been going through the contacts to get their email, and I send them messages saying that I see that you've pushed a button saying that you want to attend. Don't forget to register. Some people would say thank you, and some people would say I don't remember signing up for this, or I'm not a graphic designer. So those, I do get replies, but so far, only one person has signed up for it. The event is at least 4 weeks away.
Okay, so this is pretty fresh. So we'll be able to definitely experiment and see what the results are for you. Quick question, if we could go back just a little bit. So when you create these events in LinkedIn, are you able to dictate who receives those events? Are these people that you're already connected to? Well, I can see here that these are all first connections. So these are some people you're, okay.
Sorry. Some of them I am connected to, but others I'm not. So anyone can see this on LinkedIn, and anyone can say that they want to attend.
So when you create this event in LinkedIn, where does that, how does it show up on certain people's radar and not others?
Well, in your notifications, I'm not sure if you can see this, is right here.
Yes.
Notifications. Mm-hmm. It will show up there, and it says that you're invited.
Right. So that's, and I'm asking now more out of pure curiosity, because I'm always invited to attend these different events. And I wonder, are people actually entering in my name to specifically invite me to the event, or how is LinkedIn determining how to invite you to a specific event?
Okay, so I have invited a few people from my list, and I can go to invite connections.
Okay.
And I can see the people who haven't clicked anything, like ignore or attend, and I can go through and I can just click their names. But I was trying to go through and make sure that their title did say freelance graphic designer or something that has to do with design work, maybe even marketing.
Okay. All right. That's what I wanted to know. So at that point, they would then receive in their notifications, or actually, I think for me, it shows up under messages, not messages, under my network. The My Network tab is where I see invitations to attend events.
Okay. Yeah, and you're here's right. I got an invitation right now.
Yes. Okay. This is perfect. Stay right there. So for those of you who are listening only, we are within the LinkedIn platform and there is a tab called My Network. When you click on that tab, you can see any open invitations. So if there is someone who has sent you an invitation to connect with you on LinkedIn, that's where you would see all of this information. And from there, you have the option to either ignore or accept that invitation. But what Ericka and I are talking about is the fact that you will also see different events that you may be invited to. Now, I want to share this with you, Ericka, because I think this is also happening with people, potentially what is happening with people when they accept your event. I think it is human nature, and based off of things that I've read in different books about this, we don't like to tell people no. And the word ignore is such a strong word. Because if I were to receive this invitation to your event, Ericka, and I see it here on the back end of my LinkedIn profile, I don't want to ignore Ericka. I like Ericka. No, this is I think what's happening, because I'm guilty of this. I'll just click accept because I know the people usually that are inviting me to these events. But here's what happens. As soon as I clicked accept, there's no other indication for me to remember that event. And that's what's happening. So if you clicked accept, what happens next? Let's see what happens when you click that accept button.
I just clicked it and I don't know what happened, but I do know that there's a list of events that I have said that I would attend.
Okay.
And that's on the home page.
Okay. So you go back to the home page.
And it says events.
Okay. I must be honest with you. I never even knew that that existed until you just showed it to me. And chances are, most of the people who are clicking accept, even though we consider ourselves to be fairly savvy LinkedIn users, I had no idea that was there. I'm just being very honest with you. So what happens is I click accept. And then the next time I see a notification about that event, Ericka, is in my timeline, is in the under the notifications section that says, hey, Erica's event is about to take place in 2 hours. And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, I can't attend now. So here's the challenge. There needs to be some other form of communication from the moment someone says, yes, I want to attend, to actually attending your event. Are you familiar with, I'm sorry, go ahead.
What I have been doing, LinkedIn told me that this was a good way to stay top of mind. Once a week, I would write a post about the event.
Yes.
And my connections who said that they would accept will see these notifications. I'm not sure if I'm in the right one now.
That is a great idea. And that was also something that I was going to mention, is that definitely post about it frequently. Here's the other thing, Ericka, for people who don't know you already or who may not be connected to you at that first connection level, when they see that invitation, they're naturally going to want to go and see, well, who is Ericka Bates? When they get to your profile, what will they see that will let them know, okay, this is a lady, I want to attend her event. So let's go take a look really quickly at your profile. Consultant with Subconscious Self, Ericka Bates. You have so much more going on, Ericka, than just, oh, I'm a consultant with subconscious self. Well, what is subconscious self? But what I'm looking at in your, in the background or the banner, your LinkedIn banner, this is what it says, everyone. Freelance graphic designers attract high-paying clients in 30 days. Why not have that as part of your bio? I'm a consultant with subconscious self where I assist or I support freelance graphic designers in attracting high-paying clients in less than 30 days. That way, whenever you post something, whenever you comment, whenever you like, any type of engagement or any type of activity that you have on LinkedIn, as you know, people will always see your picture, they will see your name, and they will see that very short bio.
It's a great idea.
Make it count. So promise me, as soon as this consultation is over, that you will go in there and put in some very descriptive language, because that's the first thing people are going to see. They may not even read your banner. They may just see the image and that's it and not the words. The other thing, if we start to scroll down your image, your profile. Okay, so you have an about section. But I would love to see, I would love to see your profile actually optimized a bit more. Okay. So I know you have, I know you do all kinds of really cool graphic things. I know you're really good with different technologies that are out there. Why not showcase that here on your profile? If there are certain posts, I don't know if you realize this, I'm sure you do, but as you are posting about those reminders about your upcoming event, there's a section where you can actually, LinkedIn will give you the option to add that post to your profile. Are you familiar with that?
I'm not sure about
okay.
that.
Okay, let's go ahead. If you wouldn't mind, pull up one of your posts about the event.
I can do it from here. I can. I'm going to go to home and back to my events. Recent. Wrong one. Okay.
Okay. So if you click on the three dots in the upper right-hand corner, yes, right there. Do you see where it says, huh, that's interesting.
What?
You should see an option that says, feature this post at the top of my profile.
Oh.
That's interesting. See, LinkedIn is they do things like this. They, for example, some people are able to do LinkedIn Live and others aren't. Some people are able to create newsletters through LinkedIn and others aren't. I know at different times they will roll out new features, but not make it available to everyone on the platform right away. So I'm wondering if that's one of those things. But just be on the lookout for that, Ericka. Just know that is something that you might be able to do, hopefully in the immediate future.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. So, but for now, one of the things that you could do is, I know you have these really beautiful graphics. You can start adding those graphics directly as attachments to your profile.
Okay.
Just anything to liven up your profile, make it more engaging, and make it very clear about what you do. Another thing that I would suggest is that once people, again, if they see this invitation to attend your event and they want to learn more about you as the facilitator of this event, in your about section, is it only those three lines that you have in your about section, or is there more to it?
That's it.
Okay, we need to change that, Ericka. Seriously, you're so talented and you have so many wonderful things that you have going on. This is your time to shine and literally tell people about you. So I want you to think about it this way. If you were to go to an actual networking event and you start meeting different people face to face and you shake hands, you you naturally will ask each other, hey, what do you do? This is what I do. What would you tell them about what you do, about you, yourself, and the work that you do, and who you do that work for? Okay. This is what people would be looking at. But right now, they don't have a whole lot to go off on. So they're like, I don't know. Well, maybe I'll click on the attend event button. And then what happens after that is this is a paid event, right?
Right.
So it's very difficult to convert people who don't already know you and aren't already familiar with your work. Okay. So here's where the landing page may come in handy for you. So from the moment someone presses and says, I'm going to attend this event, do you have any other way of capturing their email addresses? Or when you do take the time to reach out to each person that said, yes, I will attend this event, maybe what you could do as an immediate next step is to send them a link to this page, to this landing page that you have right here. And I must tell you, that's a lot of words.
Yeah.
That's a lot of words. They're not going to read it. Yeah. So again, for those who don't have the benefit of seeing this on the screen right now, the video version of this episode, we are looking at Ericka's landing page that she's created that talks more about herself, the event, her company, as well as what the agenda is for the event. There's even a video here, but there is a considerable amount of text before you even get to the video.
Yes.
Here's the other thing, Ericka. One thing that I've learned from my digital marketing friends, you have to be able to offer something for free in exchange for their email address. So I would say before you even get to this particular landing page, is there another landing page that you could consider creating where you offer just very basic information? I'm going to have this informational webinar about how to attract more clients in 30 days. Have it as a teaser. And it might only last for 30 minutes or an hour, whatever you're willing to do. But I want you to pack that with so much valuable content that by the time that webinar, that workshop is over, they're going to definitely want more information. Then they might be primed and ready to actually pay for additional content. That's the formula that seems to work, Ericka. I've seen this quite a bit. The other thing that I wanted to ask you about, is this really where your audience plays online? If we're talking about creatives, is LinkedIn really the place where you would see a lot of these creatives and graphic designers?
Truthfully, I found creatives on a lot of different platforms.
Okay.
LinkedIn is the easiest place for me to get their contacts. Yes. I do have a program called Find That Lead and Reply to help me find emails. But I haven't really used them. I just mostly stick to LinkedIn. I thought if I learned one platform well, I would be able to use it well.
Yes.
That's what I was hoping.
Yes. So here's the thing. What I do know about Instagram, are you on Instagram, by the way?
I am, but I don't use it as much as LinkedIn.
Okay. That's the place where the graphic designers and the artistic folks are, because Instagram is so visual. And I was just sharing this with someone else recently. I actually signed up for, this is a great example that might give you some food for thought. I signed up for a free introduction to Instagram for your business type webinar. This was about 2 years ago. It was free. It was an hour in length. It was online and it was jammed, packed with information. Oh my gosh, it was overwhelming. But she did such a great job in providing so much information, but she gave just enough to say, to whet your appetite, to want to know even more. So she might say, you know what, I'm going to give you some really valuable content, but guess what? There's even more. And if you sign up, and I was floored by the number of people that were signing up, because she had some type of tool where you could actually see how many people were starting to register live for her event as the event was still taking place. It was unbelievable. And what she did is she said, you have to go to this particular website, which was a landing page. That's where you provided your first name, your last name, and your email address. And that started the whole process of working you into that infamous sales funnel. So you have a great thing here. We just have to figure out how to entice people, or how to point direct people along that path. So they took the first step in saying, yes, I want to attend this event. Maybe a very next step in the process then, Ericka, is if you're reaching out to them directly through messaging in LinkedIn, send them a link. You can have a script that says, hey, Jane Doe. Hi, John Smith. Thank you so much for signing up for my event. Here is a link where you can download a free report, or I'm going to have a free informational session. Or maybe before you even get to the, maybe it could be something before the event actually takes place. If it's possible for you, I don't know if you have enough time to put something like that together. But I just feel as though there needs to be something in between you making the financial ask and actually having them say they want to attend the event. And here's the other challenge, Ericka, because we're still in the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic. Unfortunately, there is the expectation for things to be free. Unfortunately. I think we're starting to turn the corner on that. At least I certainly hope so. But so many people were offering things for free. And I think now others are starting to realize, especially for those event planners who had these different conferences and other types of in-person events that they had planned and scheduled, they realize we can't just offer this for free. We have to charge some type of a fee. But I can almost guarantee you 100% that anyone who is charging for any type of online event, they have something that they can offer people for free before they actually sign up for that event.
Yeah, I thought I was doing that with the video of the first mastermind. Does that count?
How long is that video?
About an hour.
Okay.
An hour and 30 minutes.
Okay. I don't know that people would sit down and watch 90 minutes of content. But if you gave them a short report that was very that spoke to that audience, that had a lot of those really nice, beautiful visuals, they might be willing to give up their email address just to be able to download whatever type of report you would provide them. Five things that you probably didn't know that you needed to know as a freelance graphic designer. Or five things that you can do as a freelance graphic designer right now to become more profitable. Something along those lines. But I still think maybe what you could also, this is where A/B testing could come in. You could technically have two different versions of a landing page and send one group of people to one, which has the full video, and send the other half to another landing page that has a truncated version of this video. Okay. So maybe instead of the full 90 minutes, it could just be 10 minutes. Something that's a little bit more digestible, but something where if a person watched that, they would say, oh my gosh, that was great. I definitely would sign up for a full course that I would have to, or a full event that would be a paid for event.
Okay, you got me thinking.
Okay, and how often are you posting on LinkedIn?
They told me to do it once a week for best practice. my week is up, and my next post will be about the featured speaker, Keisha White.
Okay. Are you posting other content throughout the week?
No.
Okay, that's another big miss for you. That's another huge
opportunity. Once a week.
You need to post every day.
No.
Like seriously, every day. I just told that to Clarence Levy and Derek Gauthier on a previous episode. Seriously, post every day, because here's what happens, Ericka. Not everybody is on LinkedIn every day, and they're certainly not on there at the same time every day. So just because you're posting about your event, let's say you posted today on a Monday at 12 p.m. Eastern time, there are people who may be on the West Coast who haven't seen it. Or likewise, other people on the East Coast, they're usually taking a lunch break around that time. They may not be looking at LinkedIn. They may be looking into, they may be worried about trying to clear out their inbox, their email inbox during their lunch breaks. You have to play around with different times of day that you post. In general, if you have a general idea that most of the people who are likely to attend your event are in the same time zone as you, your best bet for reaching business people is very early in the morning. Somewhere between 6 a.m., actually, I would say 5:30 a.m. and 7:30 a.m. That's a little trick that I learned a couple of years ago. The other thing is, if you know that there would probably be a significant amount of people, let's say on the Western coast of the United States, that would attend your event, and they're 3 hours behind you, time zone wise, you might want to time your post to where you actually post about your event, let's say at 9:30 Eastern time. That way it would be 6:30 on the West Coast. So for people who are in California, Oregon, Washington, that area. But I insist that you find something to post about that showcases your skills, your expertise, and the value that you provide every weekday at a minimum.
Understood.
Okay. And it is a lot of work. But that's the thing. People, even as much as I post, there's still a lot of people that still don't know me. And that's just how this thing works. Everyone is so distracted. And unfortunately, we are in the business of trying to work through that, all of that distraction, and say, hey, pay attention to me. Those are just some things that come to mind. Now, we've been walking through a process, and something else that I should mention is that you definitely want to make sure that there is some type of follow-up. So once you, if you are able to direct them to one of your landing pages, you now have something that you can offer them for free in exchange for their email address. What comes next? Do you then
have them join a newsletter?
Yes. Ding, 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 ding. If we were on a game show, ding, 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 ding. Yes, you absolutely have to build a list, so that you can continue to stay in front of people. Because again, even though you may be connected to one person across several social media platforms, and Ericka, as much as you may talk about your event, that person that you're connected to on Instagram, Twitter, Pinterest, TikTok, YouTube, all of these other platforms, they still may not know that you have that event coming up on October 3rd.
October 5th.
Sorry about that, Ericka. Oh, and it's right here in front of me, right here on the screen in front of me. But if you send a newsletter also, they may very well see that newsletter, and they may not see anything else that you've actually put on social media. That's what happens because social media is so incredibly dynamic and it's moving so incredibly fast. As people are scrolling through their feeds, they only have a tolerance to scroll for so long before they stop scrolling and they realize they have to move on to something else. And so we just want to make sure that you experiment with different times of day that you're posting. Again, that you're posting at least every Monday through Friday, specifically about information that pertains to your audience and what your audience would be interested in. And you're going to add them to your email list. And again, just continue to provide more value to them. Then they would be ready to say, you know what? Oh my gosh. Oh, Ericka's offering. She's given me great content on LinkedIn. She's offered me something for free in exchange for my email address via this landing page. Now I'm on her newsletter. I've taken a look at her newsletter. There's some really good information on her newsletter. Yes, I would actually pay to attend that event. So that's a process that you can consider implementing.
Like that.
Any questions?
I wasn't doing it. It's like perspective for me now.
It's a lot. It's a lot of steps. And I applaud LinkedIn for putting something like this in place. But there are some additional things that need to be done in order to really get the most bang for your buck in terms of you're putting in a lot of time having to reach out to the different people who've said that they would like to attend the event. That's a lot of time. I already have an appreciation for just how much time that's probably taking you. Can you do me a favor and stop sharing your screen? Because there's something that I'd like to share with you as we come up. Okay, perfect. So we've talked about this process that you're going to start playing around with. And there could be, again, two different versions of the landing page. What most people would refer to, digital marketers especially, would refer to as A/B testing. Now, process is just one component, though, of the overall business infrastructure that we're going to be talking about. The other two components are people and tools and technologies. And if you're listening to this or if you're watching this for the first time and you don't know what the heck business infrastructure is, it's simply a system for how you link your people, your processes, and your tools in a way that is profitable and sustainable. So let's get to the people component, Ericka. There is, and I think you've already listened to this episode, but Kimberly Fennell. I want to give a shout out to Kimberly because she has a virtual assistance company that provides back office support for people like us who don't have the time. And frankly, the thought of having to put all of these intricate little steps in place is daunting. And
yes,
you know, yes,
that's the word.
It's very daunting. But she loves doing things like that. Her company is very good at doing things like that. So I want to pull up, I'm going to share on the screen here, Kimberly's, this is at businessinfrastructure.tv, and I want to share her podcast episode. So if you're just listening to this only, if you go to businessinfrastructure.tv and do a search, you can either do a search for Kimberly Fennell, her last name is spelled F like Frank, E-N-N-E-L-L, or you could do a search for episode 112. The name of the episode is Planning and Conducting Remote Events. It's an excellent interview. You should definitely listen to it. But more importantly, and probably what would have even more impact for you, especially Ericka at this point, is looking at the show notes because it's packed with all kinds of examples of how you can put on these digital or online events, as well as some of the different tools. Now, this is ClickFunnels. I'm not sure if you, have you had a look at this site yet, this page on the website?
haven't seen that, but I am familiar with ClickFunnels.
Okay, so you're already familiar with that, but she also talked a lot about Facebook Live for businesses. Again, I suspect that the people that you really are targeting, you would have or gain faster traction using Instagram and maybe even Facebook as well.
Okay.
Yes.
I had a hard time with Facebook, so I kind of
just
fell off.
Yeah, Facebook, I know. Here's the thing. Something else that I have noticed as I've watched different, you know, successful online marketers, they almost always have Facebook groups. So what they will do is they will get you into their funnel, and then they will say, Ericka, if you want access to this free X, sign up, give us your email address. We're then going to email you a link to our private Facebook group. There's something very magical about telling people that they're about to receive exclusive VIP private members only access. They want it. They want it badly. But this is a place for people to engage. And I'll give you an example. There is a person, a very famous YouTuber by the name of Sean Cannell. And I got sucked into Sean's funnel, hook, line, and sinker. And the way it happened, I was trying to look up how to do something with video. I did a search online. One of his videos came up. It was amazing. It answered exactly, it told me exactly what I was looking for. And then he said, you know, I have a link. Go to this particular website, sign up, and you can keep getting good information like this, all free. So I was like, hey, why not? What's the harm? So I went to the website, signed up, provided my email address. And over time, I have given a lot of money to Sean. I am now a part of Sean's Facebook group, private Facebook group. But the point is, he provided a lot of really free, valuable, extremely valuable content up front. And the more, because he had so much content out there, I was able to really get a sense of not only who he is, but the quality of his work. And by the time I started receiving the emails regarding a conference that he had in Las Vegas back in 2019, it was a no-brainer for me. It really was. And it was worth the airline ticket and the Airbnb and all that stuff, Ericka, to be able to go to that one day conference. That's what I want for you. So the name of the game, you're in the content game now. Just start taking, and I'm sure you have all kinds of things already stored away, probably somewhere that you can start leveraging, and just start putting that content out there.
Yes.
And
I even got a program for that.
Okay. Awesome. And start exploring these different platforms. I always tell people, I personally don't think it's good to just focus on one platform. I would say start with one, get good and get comfortable with it, but then start to explore some of the other ones. Because sometimes what you'll notice is you might pick up the same audience, but they're going to ask a completely different set of questions, or they may interact with you in a completely different way. And at the end of the day, I know this is hard to believe, as many millions millions of users as there are of LinkedIn, it's still not the number one platform.
Yeah, I think it's like number 5 or 25, something like that.
Yeah, I doubt it's 25, but it might be more like number 5. But I say that because, again, especially for the people that you are targeting, the creatives, the people in the graphic design space, especially freelancers, I'm telling you, my dear, they are on Instagram for sure. For sure.
All right.
And because Instagram is so visual, it's basically a digital magazine. You'll attract people alone with your imagery. And then you can start paying for ads where you can actually pay to promote your event on LinkedIn. On Instagram. That's how I found out about that Instagram class that I signed up for. It was a paid ad. And I'm sure she got her money. She definitely received a return on that investment.
I did see an ad for, Instagram class, but from Neil Patel.
Oh, okay.
I saw it today.
Yes. Yes. And I'm familiar with his name as well. Yes. That's talking about the people that you could potentially get involved. So if you just don't have the stomach for doing all of this yourself, I would definitely recommend looking into the services of a virtual assistant to help set all of this up, but make sure that is a person who understands how funnels work, who understands how to set up landing pages, and who can really help you make sure that you don't miss any steps in that process of setting everything up.
Okay.
Do you have, this was a question that I asked in my video response to you. Do you use an email marketing system right now?
Yes, I use SendFox.
Okay. I'm not familiar with that one, but okay. So as long as you have one, which is great. But I was going to also mention aweber.com. They have a lot of great videos, as well as other resources, blog articles to really talk about that really talk about list building. And in fact, I know where this is being pre-recorded. It's live, but it's still being pre-recorded. But just as a heads up, the CEO of AWeber is actually going to be on the podcast next Sunday. So be on the lookout for that. His name is Tom Kulzer. Great guy. And he actually created the very first email marketing system known to man. So before the MailChimps and Constant Contacts and all of those other companies. And it sounds like, I mean, obviously you already know about landing pages, but lead pages I know is a really popular one, a popular tool that many people use to create their lead pages. And you can sign up for a free trial. Got tongue twisted there. You can sign up for a free trial to actually design your lead page. And so for everyone who's listening, that's leadpages.com. Another great thing to do, Ericka, is to, have you ever played around with Google Ads by any chance?
I haven't.
Okay. Sign up for a free account, and here's why. Even if you don't create an ad, Google Ads comes with this amazing tool called the Keyword Planner. You can actually start typing in terms that you think would attract people online to your content, and they're going to tell you the popularity of those keywords. And it might surprise you how some language that you're using may not be that popular. So
yeah.
that's an excellent tool to use as you start to draft your posts, as you start to use hashtags across these different platforms, as you also think of the title to give your different events that you're going to continue doing in the future. Just think about that tool and play around with that first. Use different variations just to see what the tool actually generates in terms of popularity.
Okay.
And I think that is all that I can think of right now. Do you have any other questions?
I don't think so. I do have a lot to think about, to implement, because as soon as you say things, I thought that's an idea. I need to make an ebook out of a section of that video for an opt-in page.
Oh, that would be awesome.
I need to make a newsletter, and I need to finish copy and pasting all of those names so I can send out follow-ups.
Absolutely. And here's the other thing about your ebook. So there's another tool called Descript, D-E-S-C-R-I-P-T. In fact, I'll try to pull it up really quickly on the screen here so we can take a look at it together.
Okay.
It can actually take your video and transcribe it for you. Okay, yes, this is the website. So Descript.com. But just know, there are several transcription services that are very, very affordable. And you can literally just upload your video and it would transcribe it for you. You can then take that transcription and put it into an ebook format. There is another tool, and I'll have to think of the name of it. I'll definitely make sure I get that to you and make sure it gets into the show notes. But you can also take any content that you have and create these very beautiful ebooks using templates that these companies, that this particular company already has in place. The name, I'm drawing a blank on the name right now, but I'll definitely make sure I get you a link to that.
I was going to use a Beacon, but a designer seemed pretty nice.
Designer, yes, that's the one. Designer, yes, designer, and that's spelled designrr.com. In fact, I'll go there really quickly just so people can see what it looks like. That's the one. Thank you. Yes.
I'm not sure if you're familiar with repurpose.io, but it connects with Designer. Repurpose will cut up your videos into little snippets like you were telling me to do to 10 minutes. Mm-hmm. That means, for me, that meant to go to Repurpose. So, okay. And Designer, Repurpose will send it to Designer, and Designer will make an ebook for you, but you have the ability to adjust everything.
Okay, so there you go. There you go. You have, so you'll have your ebook by the end of the week, right?
I hope so. I'll most likely have the ebook before I finish copy and pasting all of those email addresses.
Well, copying and pasting email addresses for what reason? To put into your...
I put them into my email autoresponder so I can create a drip.
Okay. All right. Just making sure. So when you have your landing page, it's not connecting to your email marketing?
Only if they sign up for the event. It's like in LinkedIn, all they do is say that they'll attend. They have to actually sign up for the event when they go to the landing page.
Right. So on your landing page, so for example, if we were using an AWeber or a MailChimp or even Constant Contact, for example, if that landing page was created in one of those platforms, the minute someone signs up using, let's just say, even if it's just their first name and email address, it automatically will update your email list within that platform. So there would be no need to copy and paste. And if your list is under, I think for most of them, if your list is under 500 people, you can use the service for free. So it may be something worth exploring, a different email marketing system.
It's, I guess they didn't really opt in. They just told LinkedIn that they would attend.
Right.
So I don't, maybe I should hook up my email platform instead of the landing page to the event. That way, if they did want to opt in, they could. Right now, it's not set up like that. It just goes to the page I showed you.
Yeah. So you can test it. Again, remember how we were talking about maybe take a certain group of people and test it, doing it one way, testing another group of people, and just to see what actually works and what's going to give you the conversion. Now, I do know from, and I don't know if this percentage has changed over the years, but I've always heard, and again, I don't know if this is the latest figure, but if you can get at least a 10% conversion, you're doing well. Anything over that, you're doing, you know, really well. So I would say the goal is, you know, or a benchmark is for the number of people who actually sign up to attend the event, how many of them actually convert? Convert meaning they actually provide you an email address. And then from there, how are you then able to convert people who go to the landing page into actual participants at your event? So there's several different things to track there. So
writing it down.
Yes. Now, as you're doing that, what's the best way for people to get in touch with you, Ericka, and to keep up with all of these great things that you have going on?
LinkedIn, but I'm going to use or utilize my Instagram account more now.
Okay. And what's your Instagram handle?
ESD Bates.
ESD Bates. So that's E like Ericka, S like Sam, D like demand, Bates, B-A-T-E-S. Okay.
That's it.
That's on Instagram. And I know on LinkedIn. So for those of you listening and you want to get in touch with Ericka and maybe connect with her on LinkedIn or even just follow her, her first name is spelled E-R-I-C-K-A. Last name is B like boy, A-T like Tom, E-S. Ericka Bates. And again, on IG, her handle is ESD Bates. Ericka, thank you so much. I told you it'd go by fast.
Yeah, it did. Thank you.
Thank you
so
much.
I got a lot of details.
Good. I'm glad. And well, I'm definitely going to be checking back in with you. I definitely want to know about the success of your event, how many people you're able to actually convert. And I'm going to be giving an update on your progress on the very last episode of this season. So I'll definitely be checking in with you. Let's recap this lead to customer conversion process in three main phases. Phase one, before the click. Now, keep in mind the steps that I'm about to describe, although I may say LinkedIn specifically, just know that they can be applied to other online platforms as well. Step one, go where your potential customers hang out online. In Ericka's case, that happens to be LinkedIn. Step two, look to see who's active. Just because people have profiles on these different platforms doesn't necessarily mean that they're active. It's important to then invite them to connect, those that are active. Fourth, create a group that serves as a space for these active connections to network not only with you, but with each other. Fifth, share valuable content and tag your new connections where appropriate. The idea is to get people used to you as well as the value that you offer. Now, I recommend doing this for at least 3 to 4 months before you move on to the next phase, phase two, which is the click. Create an event on LinkedIn. Make sure you really study the copy that you're using, the images, the color, in general, the overall aesthetics of your event and how you're actually presenting it. Keep in mind also that so many users now are looking at things from their mobile devices. So you may be on your laptop as you're actually creating these events, but you always have to keep in mind, how is this going to show up on a much smaller screen if someone is looking at this event from their phone? Next, post the event publicly. In other words, if you're on LinkedIn, don't just share it to your specific group. Put it out there to everyone. Share it as a public post. And then you can share the event specifically with your group. Next, make sure you do some A/B testing. Now, here are just some ideas that we discussed with Ericka. One of the ideas was she could create a landing page with an offer in exchange for an email address from that particular person. Then she could send them an email about the specific event. The other thing that she could do is send messages one by one individually to each potential customer. Yes, I know that's very tedious and it's going to take a long time, but trust me, it goes a long way when you reach out to someone personally, inviting them to attend your event. So as you reach out to these people individually, tell them about your event and ask them if it's okay if you can send them an email where you can provide more information about the event. Also, remember that testing not only includes whether you do a landing page, whether you ask for an email address, do you provide a specific offer? Testing can also mean experimenting with the time of day that you send out the message. What day of the week are you sending out the message? Those also play a considerable factor in the response rate as you're posting about events. Now let's talk about phase three, what I call beyond the click. Once you've done your different A/B testing, you can now monitor the difference. Study those numbers. Wherever you're seeing the higher conversion, do more of that. And lastly, just continue fine-tuning the process so that your lead to customer conversion is at least 20%. As with many things in business, increasing your lead to customer conversion is one big experiment. And I'm sure you've guessed, it's a lot of work. But I have no doubt that Ericka is up for the challenge. So what do you think? Will Ericka increase the conversion rate for her online events? Is she going to continue checking on what's going on behind the proverbial curtain and making adjustments as needed? The best way to find out is by making sure you subscribe to the podcast and to our YouTube channel at businessinfrastructure.tv. By doing so, you'll receive a notification when the last episode of this season, which is season 10, premieres. And that's where I'll give an update on Ericka's progress. In fact, you can even request your own private one-on-one consultation with me. We'll also have links to all of the resources mentioned during this episode in the show notes, including a presentation I gave a few years ago on how I increased a lead to customer conversion process using SlideShare. Again, you can find all of that information and so much more at businessinfrastructure.tv. As always, thank you so much for tuning in and for being a loyal subscriber. Remember, stay focused, be encouraged. This entrepreneurial journey is a marathon and not a sprint. Until the next time. She does have some really amazing things going on for freelance graphic designers and other creatives. Make sure you follow her on LinkedIn. Again, that's Ericka Bates. You can also find her on her Instagram channel, where she's going to be doing even more activity now as a result of our conversation. And her handle there is ESD Bates. Ericka, thank you so much.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Oh, my pleasure.